My name is Spencer Overton, and I'm the president of the Joint Center for Political and Economic Studies, which is America's Black think tank. Thanks so much for joining us today to talk to Congresswoman Terri Sewell for this latest installment of our Voice at the Table series. Now, before we get started, I'd like to thank our amazing team that organized this event, including Takiya Warden, Chandra Hazlett, Jessica Fulton, and the entire Joint Center staff, as well as Marlissa Hudson and Renisha Best. I'm also appreciative of our fabulous board led by Board Chair Paul Thornell, who conceived of these Voice at the Table events. Now, I'll start us off with the discussion with the Congresswoman, and then we'll shift to audience Q&A and comments. Please use the Q&A function to let us know if you have a question. Tell us, you know, where you're from, the basics of your question, so that when we queue you up, we're really ready to go here. The chat box is for comments only. Now, Congresswoman Terri Sewell, she's in her sixth term representing Alabama's 7th Congressional District. She's one of the first women elected to Congress from Alabama in her own right, and she's the first Black woman ever to serve in the Alabama Congressional delegation. She sits on the exclusive House Ways and Means Committee, which is the chief tax writing committee of the House. Ways and Means has jurisdiction over all taxation, tariff, and other revenue raising measures, as well as Social Security, unemployment insurance, Medicare, TANF, and other matters. She brings to the committee her more than 15 years of experience as a securities and public finance attorney. Now, Congresswoman Sewell has held several leadership positions in Congress, including freshman class president, this current term, you know, back in the 112th Congress, this current term, she was selected by Democratic leadership to serve as chief deputy whip, and she sits on the prestigious Steering and Policy Committee, which sets the policy direction of the Democratic caucus. Congresswoman Sewell is a member of the Congressional Black Caucus, where she's co-chair of the Voting Rights Task Force. And I've personally always appreciated the many opportunities she's given me and as a voting rights scholar and the Joint Center to participate in the discussion about voting rights. She's also the co-chair of the Rural Caucus. As a proud product of Alabama's Rural Black Belt, Congresswoman Sewell was the first Black valedictorian of Selma High School. She's an honors graduate of Princeton University and Oxford University in England, and received her law degree from Harvard Law School, where I first had the opportunity to get to know her. You know, I looked up to her back then, and I continue to do so. And I'm so happy to welcome an old friend to the Joint Center. Congresswoman Sewell, welcome.
Thank you so much, Spencer. It's indeed a pleasure for me to be on this program with you today, but also to see how your amazing career has blossomed and bloomed and the intersections that we've been able to make over the years. And so this is indeed an honor for me to be here, to be able to talk to you as a part of this this program.
Well, thank you. And thanks for your continued just support and leadership here. So now let's go ahead and get into it. And I mentioned before you're on the House Ways and Means Committee. Now, if Republicans take control of the House, it's anticipated that they'll try to damper the IRS's enforcement authority by preventing the hire of 87,000 new IRS employees that were, you know, recently authorized by legislation. There's concern that they'll make the Trump tax provisions permanent, that they'll launch investigations into the Biden administration on COVID unemployment relief spending and the child tax credit. So tell us about what you think are the implications of Republican control of House Ways and Means for Black communities. Also, you know, what would it mean for the committee's racial equity initiative, which you co-chair? And are there any areas of bipartisan agreement related to tax policy or trade that you think might actually move forward?
Well, thank you for the question. Let me just say that it turns out that last Tuesday's midterm election has proven to be a lot better for the Democrats than we thought. So we're still holding out hope. As of the airing of this program right now, we don't know for sure whether or not the Republicans will take control. But having said that,
I'm a professor, so I engage in these hypotheticals. So sorry.
agreed. It ain't over till the fat lady sings, as my mother would say. But having said that, I think that if the Republicans do take control, they'll take control with a very small margin. It won't be this big red wave that they had predicted, but rather a trickle. Most pundits do say that we will lose control. Having said that, you know, the Biden administration has put equity, racial equity and equity, as one of its hallmark for this administration. So, you know, when I think about racial equity in the Ways and Means, I think about all of the great work that my co-chairs and I, Congressman Stephen Horsford and Congressman Jimmy Gomez, all three of us were chosen by the chair of the Ways and Means Committee, Richie Neal, to literally look through the prism of race equity for all of the legislation that comes through Ways and Means. And, you know, irrespective of who's in charge of Congress, the House, you know, or even my committee, my job stays the same. And that is to try to make sure that that in all things that I'm doing, I'm prioritizing the communities that I serve, which is a majority minority community, African-American. And it has been my priority and duty to the Black communities that I represent to remain a vocal member of the House Ways and Means Committee, advocating for health and equity when it comes to health disparities, economic incentives that the REI has laid out over the past 2 years. And we have been able to really help craft the American Rescue Plan. You saw in that plan, the Earned Income Tax Credit, as well as a child tax credit being fully funded only for 1 year. But the amazing advancements that were made in the child tax credit alone helped to lift millions of Americans out of poverty and millions of children out of poverty. I can tell you that in my district of Alabama alone, you know, we were able to really help, 76,000 families in my district alone. So I know that those are really good programs that we hope to expand and extend. It will be obviously harder under a Republican rule, but I do believe that we've laid the groundwork with our Republican colleagues to keep top of mind certain advances that have been made. For example, I think telehealth is here to stay. And so I do believe that working with my Republican colleagues, we will see telehealth, the reimbursement for telehealth extended, and efforts to increase broadband and making sure that we are utilizing telehealth to close the access gap. Because my Republican colleagues, while they may not be focused on race equity, they are focused on the difference between rural and urban areas. And frankly, I represent a majority minority rural district, right? Selma, everyone knows of Selma because of the bridge, but really Selma is a town of 19,000 and it serves as the queen city of nine other rural communities that surround Selma. And we have really been able to benefit with the work that I've been able to work with my Republican colleagues on when it comes to the health disparities that exist, whether that's health disparities for kidney failures, renal failure, health disparity in obesity, health disparities that exist in access to workforce issues, which frankly have been things that I've been able to work with Republicans across the aisle. I think all of us would agree that we need more internal medicine physicians in rural communities and underserved urban communities. And so working with my GME bill, I have bipartisan support. We've been able to get more slots for residency programs under both the Republican Trump's administration, as well as Biden administration. So I do believe that there are going to be some overlap. I do believe that when it comes to economics, that we may see a stall in the global minimum tax efforts that Janet Yellen and frankly the United States have really, the 15% global minimum tax initiative will, you know, has really reached, has stalled on the European side. In fact, I just got back from Spain where we were talking about this in Madrid with members of the EU, as well as members of parliament across the EU. And so, you know, I think that there is some concern that Republicans will stall efforts on that. And I do believe that they, you know, that they will also double down on their Tax Cut and Jobs Act of 2017. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I put a pin in that and hope that we don't see that much happening on the health side, but I do anticipate that we'll see more rigorous trade negotiations being pressed the Biden administration being pressed to do more trade negotiations. And I do believe that they're going to also double down against enforcement of our IRS agents and implementation of that part of the Inflation Reduction Act. So, you know, I think that you will see us Democrats continue to put, you know, to extend an olive branch when it comes to racial and equity initiatives. In fact, Chairman Neal held a first ever full committee hearing on racial equity initiatives and ways and means in particular. And we heard our Republican colleagues say that they wanted to be, be a part of that and to help, you know, help in that particular area. And so we'll call them to task on that, Spencer, and hope that they will allow us to continue to work on those measures. But irrespective, you will see myself, Stephen Horsford, Jimmy Gomez, and the House Democrats on Ways and Means continue our effort to see the work of this committee through a racial equity lens.
Let me go just a little bit deeper and follow up on something you said. You talked a little bit about trade and tariffs here. You know, there's certainly kind of the, you know, MAGA Republicans who are very skeptical of trade here and kind of multilateral institutions. And there are some other Republicans who are more open to it. I think on the Democratic side, there may be kind of a split a bit as well. So what do you, are there any opportunities in terms of, you know, trade and tariffs and kind of expanding American jobs through trade and then also protections in terms of trade agreements for workers to, you know, ensure that, you know, others, you know, it's not a race to the
bottom,
you know,
yeah,
to the bottom, right?
No, look, I think that the U.S., the negotiations that we saw with NAFTA 2.0 or USMCA, I was a part of a small working group of 10 Democrats. And you saw for the first time, you know, a lot of labor concentrated Democrats vote in favor of a trade agreement. And I think that that model where we saw stronger labor conditions being imposed on the trade agreement, where we saw efforts to strengthen our trade enforcement provisions with the WTO, where we really saw compromise among Republicans and Democrats around trade with the USMCA, that is a model for going forward. And look, I can tell you that one of the tax credits that I have championed enjoys a lot of bipartisan support, and that's the New Market Tax Credit Extension Act, which would permanently make a home for the national, you know, for the new market tax credits within the U.S. Tax code. The bill has over 120 co-sponsors and was included in the Build Back Better markup that was in Ways and Means that we, that committee hearing, the markup back in September of 2021. And it's my hope that Chairman Neal will include this legislation in an end of the year tax legislation that comes before the committee, if not to make it permanent, to definitely extend it, right? It's been, it enjoys a wide bipartisan support. So I think that you will see that in trade and in tax, you will see there are certain areas of common ground, whether it's on tax credits that deal with research and development, which we, you know, the initiative The Moonshot Initiative on cancer is something that enjoys bipartisan support. And, you know, I think that you'll see us come together on certain measures, whether that's tax credits and the extension of tax credits, or that's, you know, working together on lifting tariffs and frankly, both Democrats and Republicans benefit when we have open access to markets, right? Back home, all of us benefit from that, whether it's agriculture products in Alabama or it's steel in Alabama and car manufacturing, you know, across the nation. We see that there are great benefits of trade. And I do believe the USMCA negotiation really shows us a path forward where Democrats and Republicans can find middle ground on important trade legislation.
Mm-hmm. Appreciate that. You also talked a little bit about the earned income tax credit and child tax credit and, you know, those being expanded during the pandemic and really reducing poverty for many children and adults. You know, the Joint Center has done some work in this area to really expand the EITC because currently, you know, households without children, you know, you can have someone who has children, but if they're not living in the same household as their child, you know, they can really be taxed into poverty as a result of a restrictive EITC. So where are the conversations on both, you know, CTC expansion and EITC expansion headed, you think, in the, you know, the coming months?
Well, I think that having a Republican-controlled House will definitely, I wouldn't say halt those negotiations, mm-hmm. but I would say it won't be a priority for them. But it right. remains a priority for Democrats and our Democratic senators, as well as this administration. You know, the expansion of several key tax credits for struggling families is one such example of where new tax revenue can help fund the cost of policies that will uplift families and reduce inequities. The Ways and Means Committee has been working tirelessly, led by the Racial Equity Initiative that I chair with Gomez and Horsford. We will continue to try to create a roadmap for expansion of social safety net programs. None are more important than the child tax credit and the earned income tax credit. But it also means that we are also working tirelessly to try to make sure that we have, you know, dependent care tax credits and that we continue to work to try to expand opportunities for childcare. Because we know that when women work and when households have better childcare, then parents can work better and our productivity as a nation and our economic productivity as a nation only benefits from that. So mm-hmm. I do believe that the tax code could be a powerful weapon for creating better social nets, mm-hmm. not only for African Americans, but for low income families writ large. So I do believe that both of those things may see that the Republicans may not have that same priority, but I know that the Democrats will continue to double down on those historic achievements that we've already had with making the child tax credit fully refundable. Mm-hmm. You know, many of my families in my district some of them don't pay taxes. So therefore they never get the child tax credit, but we now have a regime set up because we had under the American Rescue Plan, one full year of the child tax credit fully paid for, right? And we saw it was administered on a monthly basis. So we have seen ways that the IRS can be much more family friendly, if you would say, by being able to have it fully refundable and be able to have it delivered on a monthly basis. Truly game changer for many families in America and definitely in my district.
Mm-hmm. And let me also make this plug here, just, you know, substantively for our audience and then also for you. We're about to post for a tax policy director to basically build the Joint Center's tax policy program. So obviously, if you know anyone, please let us know. But I think also moving forward, we'd love to, you know, work and engage with you on these issues.
That's a very important point, Spencer. Look, you know, the tax code never mentions the word race, yet we know that the code is a reflection on, on America's values, frankly.
Right.
And when we see these big tax cuts for capital, for capital production, whether it's, you know, passive securities,
right.
capital markets, versus why we don't fully fund the child tax credit, you know,
right.
why
right.
are we focused so much on capital gains and right. not on child tax credit? And that to me, when you think about the fact that that child poverty is nearly three times as high among Black and Latino children
right.
than our white counterpart, not focusing on child tax credit has a huge racial disparity. Right. And if we do focus on the credits that would actually help working right. families, we would right. literally lift people out of poverty.
Right.
And so I can't tell you how important getting getting the Joint Center more involved on tax policy and working with us, the Ways and Means Committee, on that would be. So hats off to the Joint Center for always be make ways that we can do better as legislators and providing us with the research and the thoughtful programming that you all have allows us to continue to be on the cutting edge of making sure that that we're helping African-American families and African-Americans generally.
Thank you. I want to turn to another issue that's really close to, I think, to both of us. You know, the Joint Center has produced extensive research on the Black Rural South. We found that 38% of Black households in the Black Rural South report lacking broadband, which is almost twice as high as whites in the region, as well as rural residents outside of the South. The bipartisan infrastructure law allocated about $65 billion to close the digital divide, and a large portion of those funds will be used by states to build out broadband infrastructure in unserved areas. Now, as you know, Black voters in the Black Rural South are often not a part of the political base of statewide officials. And the Joint Center actually filed comments with the FCC. We shared them with NTIA, expressing our concern about the potential for an equitable distribution of these broadband resources. In essence, we want to make sure that state officials deploy broadband resources based on need rather than politics and equitably serve the Black Rural South. You were generous in terms of lending us your legislative director, Rob Nuttall, earlier this year for a national conference of the Association of Black Foundation Executives to highlight this issue so that foundation executives could make sure that their grantees in the Black Rural South are prepared to engage in this process in terms of deployment. So, Congresswoman, tell us about the importance of the bipartisan infrastructure law to the Black Rural South generally and with regard to broadband. And then also, what can stakeholders on this call do to help ensure that broadband is equitably deployed to the Black Rural South? We've got community leaders on the call. We've got people who are in companies who are, you know, committed to equity and want their company to do the right thing. So what is it that the folks who are on this call can do to ensure, you know, equitable deployment of broadband?
Well, obviously, to answer the last question first, that is to lift voices about the need for us to level the playing field when it comes to broadband and broadband deployment. You and I both know that, and you said it well, that that African-American communities, whether they be in rural parts or urban parts, have largely been left behind when we think about, access to broadband. And we saw that during this pandemic. We saw mm-hmm. that in stark comparison, as you saw, parents going to the McDonald's in order for their children to be able to do their homework, you know, and we saw large dependency on broadband and the need to have broadband for people to go to work, for people to learn, for people to be able to sell their goods and services. And so, you know, no one deserves, I think everyone deserves to have affordable high-speed internet, no matter where they live. And yet in the 21st century, large parts of the rural Black Belt in the South that I represent still don't have access to the internet. And, you know, urban areas may have a little more of it, but it's never as reliable as it is in white areas, right? So what we need to do is start thinking about broadband as an essential tool. Just like we electrified, America, we need to roll it out. FDR electrified the Tennessee Valley with the New Deal. We need a similar effort to bring broadband to every community, to every school, to every small business, to every home. And frankly, the bipartisan infrastructure bill is truly transformational when we think about the resources that will be available to do just that. I think about my own state of Alabama, $100 million over the next 5 years just for broadband. And it's going to be incumbent upon those of us in the federal government to oversee how these monies are being dispensed and utilized in these states. And you're right, in the Deep South, most of those state houses are run by Republicans. And so while, you know, we couldn't put a quota around it, we could incentivize states to get even more money if they prioritize, and we did that in the bipartisan infrastructure bill, you can get even more money if you prioritize underserved and rural communities. And so, you know, I think that states like Alabama, because of that incentive, you will see them doing that. But you also know that it's going to be incumbent upon those of us who carry a big stick, if you will, to have oversight over how that money is rolled out in our states. And so that means joining and working with those state agencies that will be utilizing that money. In the state of Alabama, broadband will be rolled out through ADECA, which is the economic development arm of the state. And so having conversations, not just one-off conversations, but I've set up a monthly meeting with the head of ADECA and the head of ADEM, the Environmental Department in Alabama, because they're rolling out the wastewater and the water wastewater and water infrastructure, which we all know is lacking in lots of rural southern states and southern towns. I know that I have Lowndes County in my district, and you know, being able to having water that is not filled with lead and having sanitation is a basic human need. And we in America can ill afford to have any part of our nation not have adequate water and wastewater treatment. And so, you know, that is also covered in the bipartisan infrastructure bill. And so, you know, I do believe that broadband, like I said, is not a luxury. It's going to be it is a necessity, just like electricity was. And if we could figure out how to roll that out to every hamlet, every village, every town in America, we can do the same if we have the political will when it comes to broadband. And I do believe that the bipartisan infrastructure bill gives us the resources to do just that. And so it's going to be incumbent upon us at every level of government, whether that's the federal, the state, and local, that we really harness these resources and make sure that we are demanding equitable distribution of those resources when it comes to our cities and our towns. And that starts with us lobbying our state legislators, but it also means that we have to be have broadband maps and broadband plans of action for our cities and our towns ready to go. And make sure that those are delivered to our states so that it becomes a part of a state plan, because in order to spend that money, they have to come up with a state plan and give that plan to the federal government. And so keeping all of our eyes on the ball of making sure that these resources are being equitably distributed, whether that's for broadband, roads and bridges, the money that's coming down for public transit, I mean, the money that's coming down for airport. I mean, this is a $1.3 trillion investment in infrastructure across the board, and it is truly transformational. Especially if we can figure out ways to make sure that it's done so in an equitable way, and it starts with us demanding it and making sure that we're doing our part in facilitating that equitable distribution.
Mm-hmm. And I'm also hopeful that many of our corporate partners who've made a commitment to equity will really kind of step up and provide technical assistance and really use their voices.
I mean, so many of our corporations after George Floyd were saying, how can we be helpful? And that I have to say, you know, a lot of us put out those corporate asks into implementation during this pandemic, whether it was utilizing Microsoft to provide workbooks for underserved kids who were trying to get their homework done during the pandemic, or Apple providing, you know, iPads to folks, or Verizon providing free or reduced costs for internet services. We really do need to utilize every tool in the toolkit. And I believe that what a great launching pad the bipartisan infrastructure bill will have for us over the next 5 years. We don't need to squander this opportunity. We need to make sure that we're at the table, the decision-making table, when these resources are being dispensed by our states.
So Joint Center has also done a lot on the future of work in the Black Rural South. You know, we wrote a leading report on the area. We found that displacement from automation has a particularly profound effect on residents of the Black Rural South. And in high growth areas like Seattle, displaced workers have an easier time finding new jobs because they're just more open jobs. But in the Black Rural South, where there is sometimes negative job growth, displaced workers have a harder time finding new jobs. It's kind of like musical chairs when the music stops and there's one less chair, right?
Yeah.
So what priorities are you focusing on to ensure that federal and private sector investments expand business and job opportunities in the Black Rural South?
Well, you know, I have, from the moment I got into Congress, well before I became on the Ways and Means Committee, put together a workforce development tax incentive that would help, utilize in Alabama, for example. We have the automobile industry. We represent a lot of the global, American headquarters for a lot of the foreign manufacturers, whether that's Mercedes-Benz or Hyundai or Kia. They tend to be in the South because of our labor laws, frankly. But utilizing that as a springboard to really work on making sure we have a ready workforce, ready to be able to take advantage of these opportunities. So whether it's my workforce development tax credit, which would actually incentivize apprenticeship programs to incentivize these automobile manufacturers in my district to actually partner with two-year colleges. They get a tax break if they donate the equipment, if they help hire the folks who come out of those programs. And working together, we've been able to do a great apprenticeship program at Mercedes-Benz, for example. You know, you don't have to always pass a law, but we can't use our tax code to incentivize, you know, the workforce training that's needed in order for all communities and all people in those communities to be able to take advantage of these great manufacturing job opportunities. And in fact, Alabama has been working hand in glove, the Alabama, we have a labor training facility that the state runs. And that has been an integral part in not only us being able to attract more automobile manufacturing, but manufacturing generally. I was able to get $150 million copper tubing manufacturing facility in the poorest part of my district, in the poorest part of the state of Alabama, Wilcox County. We could only do it if the state came in with tax incentives, whether that's for, you know, for roads and infrastructure, or that is for workforce initiatives. And so, you know, as a member of Congress, there are lots of ways to slice and dice this. While I have great legislation about it, you know, finding a vehicle to get that legislation passed, working with my Republican colleagues to get that piece of legislation ready for them to be supportive of it may take time. But I can leverage my position as a member of Congress to bring into one room the head of Mercedes-Benz North America and the president of two of the two-year colleges that are in my district that can benefit from some sort of joint effort on apprenticeship program and training programs, which they've done. And now, you know, we're now in like the 10th year of this apprenticeship program for Mercedes-Benz, getting Hyundai in Montgomery to do the same thing with Trenum Community College is something that we're trying to produce as well. So there are lots of ways to skin this cat, but at the end of the day, we have to make sure that all of us are investing in our greatest resource, which is our people. And it's one thing to be able to attract industry. It's another thing to be able to keep it and to expand it. And for that, you need to have a workforce that's ready. And we do know that discrimination is real. And so incentivizing those workforces to hire, you know, first of all, to train more people of color for these positions, but also then to hire them is something that I have been laser focused on, because I see that as just as important as, you know, giving a corporation a tax incentive to do that is to actually give corporations the people in the communities we have a reason to want to go and work in these amazing manufacturing opportunities. You've got to educate them. You have to meet people where they are. And that means going to the historically Black colleges and working with amazing institutions, as well as our two-year technical colleges, to create the workforce that we want to see, and to educate them. And at the same time, it's a win-win proposition. You're giving more resources to historically Black colleges, to our public universities, to our technical colleges, and at the same time, creating a workforce that will give us an opportunity to expand our economic base and our economic development opportunities. So it's a win-win proposition if we work together on workforce development issues and training issues, whether that's because of displacement of workers from trade. So we do so in the trade adjustment agreements that we do with trade agreements, and making those much more accessible to the communities that need it the most has always been the challenge, as well as to make sure that they are really funded or truly funded in a way that they could actually be helpful to transform communities and the workforce in those communities.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you. So here's what I'm going to do right now. I'm hoping you have a notepad and a pen. I am going to cut to our audience here and kind of tee them up in terms of some questions. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to take multiple questions at the same time. If possible, I may try to hone in on the same topic. So I'll tee off with kind of my last question, but then also ask Gary Fields, who has a voting question, to follow that. And then we'll turn it back over to you. So you're the co-chair of the Voting Rights Task Force for the CBC. Your district's home to the Edmund Pettus Bridge, which is, for everybody else, kind of the site of Bloody Sunday, which you all probably know, and led to the passage of the Voting Rights Act of 1965. You know, in light of this election denier movement that we've seen, in light of the Voting Rights Act case that's before the U.S. Supreme Court involving the Alabama congressional districts, you know, what's the immediate future of voting rights in the United States? You know, what do we need to do to preserve and to really secure a well-functioning multiracial democracy where everyone has a voice? And on that, let me turn it over to Gary Fields. Are you there in terms of asking your question? Just take yourself off of them. Yep.
Yep, sorry about that. Yeah, I'm here and loud and clear. My question would be, you know, democracy seemed to be on the shadow ballot last week, and voters kept it alive. My question, though, is, although it survived, does our system of government still have vulnerabilities? You know, what are the issues, and especially what are the issues that are still out there for Black voters and people of color?
Very good question. You know, it was John Lewis, the late, great John Lewis, I was so honored to have both as a colleague and as a mentor. But John said that the vote is the most effective nonviolent tool that we have in our democracy. He's absolutely right. All roads go through voting. And so the ability for all of us to have equal access to the ballot box is something that he fought for, he bled for on the Edmund Pettus Bridge, and something that is his legacy. I am honored every day to carry the John Robert Lewis Voting Rights Advancement Act, which would seek to put back into effect the federal oversight that was a part of the Voting Rights Act of 1965 to restore the enforcement provisions of that act. We have seen old battles have truly become new again as we've witnessed the most concerted, coordinated effort to restrict the right to vote in our generation. And at the same time, we're up against a Supreme Court that is really hell-bent on destroying the Voting Rights Act of 1965. And I think that they will do so with this, put yet another nail in the coffin, if you will, with the Milligan case, which is before the Supreme Court now. Ironically, it was the Voting Rights Act of 1965 and Bloody Sunday in my hometown that brought us the 65 Act. But it was also the Shelby versus Holder case that came out of Alabama that took away, the federal oversight that the Justice Department had in preclearance. And now it looks as if Section 2 of the Voting Rights Act, which allows us to be able to sue after the fact if we can show, a disparate impact. excuse me. So look, voting was not just a shadow part of the ballot. It was truly on the ballot, because when you think about the fact that, the old battle's becoming new again, our only voice in this democracy is our vote. And the fact that that because of the Shelby versus Holder case, and unfortunately, I think the redistricting cases may be coming out of Alabama, we've seen polling stations close in minority neighborhoods. We've seen limited early voting coming up. We've seen long lines at polling stations because people have closed polling stations and states didn't have to give notice ahead of time. So the laws that have been passed have been so extreme that, you know, in Georgia, it's even illegal to provide a bottle of water for someone who's standing there waiting to vote. So while, you know, we no longer have to count how many jelly beans are in a jar or recite how many counties are in a state in order to have the right to vote, the modern day efforts to stop people from voting or limiting certain populations from voting has been no less pernicious than these poll taxes and literacy tests of the past. Nevertheless, I think we have to stay vigilant in our efforts to get federal oversight when states go amok. And that's really what the Voting Rights Act of 1965 was about. And we've seen that be stopped in Congress by a filibuster of the Senate. So that even though you only need 51 votes to pass a piece of legislation, in the Senate, you need 60 votes to stop debate, to bring up that bill to be voted on. And that filibuster has stopped us not once, but twice. We've passed the John Robert Lewis Voting Rights Advancement Act out of this Congress, 117th Congress, and we passed it out of the 116th Congress. But both times it was stalled in the Senate. Ironically, the only way that we can get a vote on the House floor for the Voting Rights Act, the John Robert Lewis Voting Rights Act, is if we vote like our lives depend upon it, and we put more Democratic senators in office. Unfortunately, the voting rights is very partisan now. It used to not be. The Voting Rights Act of 1965 was reauthorized 5 times under 4 Republican presidents, most recently in 2006 under George W. Bush. And in fact, George W. Bush and Laura Bush accompanied President Barack Obama and First Lady Michelle Obama to Selma on the 50th anniversary of the Voting Rights Act of 1965, because he was proud of the fact that it was reauthorized under his watch. Now Republicans realize that when more people go to the polls and vote, that they have, that they lose races. And because of that, they are really fighting any effort to restore the Voting Rights Act of 1965. But while we can be mad about it, we have to use that anger as motivation to continue to fight for voting rights and insist that our members of Congress, our senators, vote in favor of restoring the Voting Rights Act of 1965. Just think about where we would be if John Lewis and those foot soldiers had been deterred by Bloody Sunday. They were not. They obviously, you know, lick their wounds. They patched themselves up, and then they did turn around Tuesday. And then ultimately the final march from Selma to Montgomery, which brought us the voting rights of 1965. So we have to harness our anger, our disappointment about our unwillingness to get Congress to pass the Voting Rights Advancement Act. We have to demand it. You know, change rarely comes in the halls of Congress because members of Congress just want to do the right thing. It comes by being forced to do the right thing by grassroots activism. And now more than ever, we must actively be seeking to restore voting rights.
So just 15 seconds on a follow-up on that from Peyton McCrary. I'm not going to have him come up, but I'm going to ask his question, which is, and he's a voting rights historian, which is, right now, can the Voting Rights Advancement Act, the John Lowe's Voting Rights Advancement Act, be revised to be passed in this upcoming Congress? And this isn't his question, but I'll ask it. Yeah. Or is it better just to kind of wait for a better Congress and pass a better bill?
Well, look, there are those of us who believe that if we could come to the table, Republicans and Democrats, to even talk about voting rights and restoring the Voting Rights Act of 1965, that we're willing to compromise if they even mm-hmm. would come to the table. And so, unfortunately, Republicans, you know, Tim Scott walked away from talking about it and coming to the table about it. Mm-hmm. We don't have even Lisa Murkowski from Alaska, who signed on to the Voting Rights Advancement Act in the 116th Congress, did not sign on it in the 117th Congress. So the reality is that there's only one party fighting for voting rights in Congress, and that's the Democratic Party. I know it's a priority for this administration, for the Biden-Harris administration. It's a priority for House Democrats and for Senate Democrats. The problem is we, in order for us to get it passed this Congress, this next coming Congress, or any Congress, we have to either revise the archaic filibuster rules on the Senate, or we must elect 60 Democratic senators in order for it to change. So, look, I think that many of us who are so frustrated by this whole process would welcome a Republican coming to the table willing to negotiate. But right now, we're negotiating against ourselves. And so frankly, if I have to negotiate against myself, I'm going to make the Voting Rights Advancement Act to be the dream bill that H.R. 1 and H.R. 4 was. And so, you know, it's unfortunate that we don't have any Republican representatives on the House side or senators on the Senate side who are willing to come to the negotiating table to even deal with this crisis, a crisis in our democracy. And I guess given the January 6th incident and where we are in American politics right now, that's I think that it's going to be incredibly hard to do this Congress and next Congress.
Okay. So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to go, there are going to be two big topics here. We're going to hear from like five people, two topics. First topic will be health. The second topic will be federal spending. So on health, we'll hear from Commissioner William Clyburn and then Chris Mosley. So Commissioner Clyburn, your question.
Thank you, Mr. President. And Congresswoman, thank you so much for the work that you've been doing on Ways and Means, on the Subcommittee on Health particularly. This is a personal issue that I'm becoming more involved in. How do you envision this administration focusing resources to close that stark 3-to-1 maternal health mortality and morbidity gaps that we're seeing now, using local Healthy Start associations and organizations that are on the front line and know how to help Black mothers?
Absolutely.
Thank you so much. And so let me do this. I'm going to just go through quickly so that you can, in the end, you'll have the closing remarks.
Okay.
You'll be able to address the health issues and the federal.
So I've got to talk about the Mama of Us Act that's been going through the House. Okay.
So we're going to hear from Chris Mosley next, and then we're going to shift to federal spending, hear from a couple folks, and then turn it back over to you to close this out.
Good afternoon, Congresswoman.
Hi, is this Chris from Alabama, from Birmingham? from ARMS, one of my great community health centers?
Absolutely. Congresswoman, the question that I wanted to pose to you was, could you just talk about your work around multi-cancer early detection and actually what that means for our community as we move forward in healthcare space?
Absolutely. Thank you so much for the question. And thank you for the amazing work that ARMS, this community health center, has done in Birmingham, and the willingness to share best practices with so many of our rural communities as well. Thank you, Chris.
And so now we've got just a few federal spending questions. One is anonymous, so I'll ask it. What are some best practices learned from how states and localities spent their flexible fiscal recovery funds under ARPA? You know, any examples from your district or Alabama? And then we'll hear from two more folks who have questions here. And then we'll just turn it over to you to close us out here. We'll hear from Odell Thompson from the 4th Congressional District in Mississippi. Then we'll hear from Karen Narasaki. Odell?
Yes, I'm sorry. Good afternoon, Congresswoman.
Good afternoon.
I'm going to make this very brief. You know, I'm sure everybody's heard about all the incidents that are going on here in Mississippi. And I wanted to know, is there a list of agencies for each state that will be rolling out the funds for broadband infrastructure or any of the other funding for infrastructure itself? It would be great to know who those agencies are or what the agencies are.
Thank you.
Yep.
And Karen Narasaki?
Thank you, Spencer. Hello, Congressman. I work with philanthropy, and I'm very interested in what you see the role of philanthropy in helping communities play a important influence on the broadband rollout in their communities, not just the education to communities about taking up broadband, but actually affecting policy.
Yep. Great question.
Okay, that's it. You see what I said, get out the pen and the notes here. We just want to give folks an opportunity to participate here and give you a chance to kind of wrap us up here.
So let me just start with the last question first, since that's top of mind. The question was, what role can philanthropy have? I think in the execution and deployment, I'm now adding to this, but deployment of broadband. And yes, educating and providing, doing outreach in that and in providing information and education around it has been something that a lot of philanthropy has done. The provision of actual resources, whether that's the iPads or the connectivity and the like, has been done by lots of foundations, frankly, from corporate philanthropic arms of corporations. But what I think has been lacking is an effort to figure out how to literally provide more internet service providers, like figuring out ways that philanthropy can go about providing money and resources for innovative ways to effectively deploy broadband. I can give you another example in the infrastructure space, water and sewer. I represent these small communities where people inherit land, and many of the communities can't afford, or the landowners can't afford to connect to the county water sewer line. They're too far away for it to be equitable. I mean, cost effective to actually connect, for the water authority for the city to connect to them. So they need decentralized wastewater treatment centers, right? But coming up with the innovation, which costs money, research and development, that kind of stuff, takes money and resources. And too often we think about the tangible thing, the iPad being given to a student that needs it. Hard to roll out that kind of philanthropy, right? To give the actual in user the actual tool, when you can really fund research and development opportunities and innovation and helping to have more than just the monopoly on the internet service providers have when it comes to the deployment of those resources for broadband. So that's my answer to that one. In terms of agencies that are actually rolling out the bipartisan infrastructure bill, clearly the biggest federal agency is DOT, the Department of Transportation. Having said that, for the first time, we also gave a lot of money to EPA. EPA is sitting on a lot of resources that can help in the clean water space, which of course, Mississippi, we all see that plight that's going on in Mississippi. And I know that, but for the grace of God, go all of us, because Alabama could very well, we have very fragile infrastructure when it comes to wastewater and water systems. So that could have very easily have been my state. So we all need to be figuring that out. In terms of the state agencies, because most of this money has been block granted to the states, the state agencies that will actually roll them out may differ. But if your state is like my state, broadband is being rolled out in my state by an economic development agency called ADECA, Alabama's Economic Development Agency. I don't know what the equivalent of that would be for Mississippi or for other states, but I would look at how your state, what agency rolls out, what agency is responsible for economic development. That's what, now in terms of water, wastewater, and that is being rolled out in my state by the Environmental Management Agency of that state. But I also think that the Public Health Department plays a role and will have resources that can help with that when it comes to water and sewer. I also think that agencies within every state has to come up with its own plan for how they're going to spend their Department of Transportation block grants that come to them. And so starting with your state Department of Transportation, ours is called ALDOT in Alabama, Alabama Office of Transportation, and going and getting appointment with them as to how you can make sure that these shovel-ready projects in your own community are put as a part of the state plan that's submitted to the federal government. And guess what? Because of transparency, your state DOT has to publish that, right? So going on and familiarizing yourself with your own state's map and plan for transportation will help greatly be able to get those resources. I hope that's helpful.
And I want to flag just one other agency, just because I think it's important for people to report inequity here,
yeah,
which is the Department of Commerce, yes. NTIA, yes, within the Department of Commerce. So if you think something's fishy going on the state level, and you know Black communities are not getting resources,
very good,
you should certainly let NTIA, those folks, know at the Department of Commerce with regard,
yes,
to broadband.
Commerce is actually over. Commerce is actually over the money that the broadband money from the bipartisan infrastructure bill. So that's a very good resource as well. Then the question was about on the healthcare front. I'm hoping I got everything, but on the healthcare front, when it comes to infant mortality, and in particular the disparity between Black mommies and white mommies who literally die in childbirth in this great country three times more often than white mothers do, we have passed several pieces of legislation out of the House. I'm very proud to be a part of the Congressional Black Caucus's efforts led by Robin Kelly and Lauren Underwood that deal directly with a package of bills called the Momnibus that actually passed out of Congress on the House side. And pieces of that legislation were implemented during the American Rescue Plan. And you know, whether that's giving mothers a longer, mothers that are, Medicaid recipients a longer time to stay in the hospital. You know, it used to be that only 48 hours were covered. Now there's longer coverage periods that were given under the American Rescue Plan. a foothold that we could expand, I think, more broadly into other areas. But a lot of us are singularly focused on the high disparity within childbirth, brought to light by people like, you know, Serena Williams, you know, and Allison Felix, the track runner. I mean, irrespective of economic means, Black women are dying in childbirth, you know, 3 to 4 times more than white women are. And it's just simply unacceptable. But that health disparity exists across lots of different, lots of different diseases, frankly, whether that's diabetes or hypertension and cancer. And that gets to Chris Mosley's question. I am the lead sponsor on a bill that's called the Multi-Cancer Early Detection Act. We currently have 325 sponsors in the House and about 41 sponsors on the Senate. It's something that I think is right to pass, but what it would do is it would deal with the fact that there are technologies out there that would allow a drop of blood to be able to be utilized to discover, to screen for 40 different kinds of cancers. It's an expensive therapy. It's a very expensive therapy. But my bill would make it available at a reasonable cost and covered by Medicare. And that would be a game changer because the number one factor in cancer is age. And so Medicare, because it's older population, is a perfect population to start. Obviously we wanna get it covered under Medicaid as well, but Ways and Means is in charge of Medicare. So that's what we're focusing our attention on, is trying to get it to be a reimbursable expense. And it's expensive because it would be something that has to be yearly tested, right? That it's only good for that particular time that drop of blood is taken, right? But the fact that we have these amazing technologies out there, we wanna make sure, because research and development, often funded by the federal government, has given us these amazing technological discoveries. And so we wanna make sure that it is equitably distributed and every American has opportunity to get it, especially when we think about racial disparities in cancer. This is a game changer. I recently lost my own mom to pancreatic cancer. There exists no screen for pancreatic cancer, yet pancreatic cancer is one of the discoverable screens that comes out of this blood drop that's being utilized. And so this is game changer, in my opinion, and should be a no-brainer for the Biden administration to get fully behind because of the equity issues with respect to being able to discover early on cancer. And so I would urge everyone to make sure that your congressperson, your senator signed on to that bill, because it's a really good bill. I want to close by just saying the Joint Center has been such a powerful force for good for so long when it comes to the amazing research that comes out of and scholarship that comes out of the Joint Centers, as well as the amazing experts that you guys deploy on a whole host of issues that affect the African-American community, whether it's, you know, anxiously awaiting your State of Black America or utilizing the Joint Center when I was writing my thesis in college on Black women in politics and wanted to talk about some political stuff, having an opportunity to come to the Joint Center and utilize your library was something that I did as a student. So I just wanna say it is an honor for me to be a part of your Voices at the Table series for this hour. What an honor it is also for me to have your wonderful executive director, who's a dear friend from law school, be the moderator. And I'm honored every day not only to represent Alabama's 7th Congressional District, but to be on the front lines fighting for our community, whether that is utilizing my position on Ways and Means in the area of tax and trade and health and Social Security, or it's being a member of the Congressional Black Caucus that's 58 strong. And that's because of the powerful vote that our community has had. And so I wanna end this discussion on voting rights. Please, 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 your vote does matter. We saw that in what was supposed to be this red wave being a red trickle. That was because people voted. people voted and they voted their interest. Not voting is not an option. And I'm sure that the folks who are a part of this call today are a part of the folks who know that voting is so important. But any grassroots activism that we can do and anything that we can do individually, whether that's educating our own children about the importance of voting and taking them with us to the polls, or taking your grandparents or your neighbors, never go to the polls alone. We should make sure that this is a community activity and that we're all vested in making sure that our vote is, that our vote counts and that our vote does matter. And so with that note, I just wanna again, thank you, Spencer, for giving me the opportunity to talk with you all today. But I know that on this call are powerful advocates, powerful folks that in their own way can make a difference in the health disparities that we see, the economic disparities that we see, the injustices that exist in this country, that all of us can be the change agents that we're waiting for.
Thank you, Congresswoman Sewell. And I'm also just so personally happy that, you know, you mentioned your mother. She was just such a bright light in terms of everything that she brought to the community, but also in terms of you and everything she did in terms of shaping you. I'm just privileged that I had a chance to get to know her a little bit and just had nothing, just positive energy is what I think about when I think about her. So, you know, thank you so much. We appreciate you taking the time to be with us. You've been a thoughtful and dynamic leader, and I hope the folks back home in Alabama know how well respected you are in DC, how you provide them great representation, you know, for everybody back home, including many of the folks who are my own family. I'd also like to thank everyone who's joined us here. I'm sorry we didn't have a chance to get to all the questions, but again, thanks for the engagement. Whether you're a part of the nonprofit sector or philanthropy or the private sector or government, it really takes all of us to keep things moving forward on a vibrant and inclusive economic growth and a true multiracial democracy. So you're all key to what we're trying to do in terms of moving forward. I hope you'll join us at future events. Thanks so much and have a great day.